February 10th, 1983. This is Joe Todd, interview with Floyd Belknap.
Mr. Belknap, where were you born?
Born in Missouri, LaClede County, Missouri.
Which county?
LaClede. Goes to a little town by the name of Conway.
And when's your birthday?
29th of September.
What year?
1889.
My birthday is September
89.
My birthday is September
28th. 28th? Well, we're just a day apart then.
Yeah. Who was your father?
My father was George William Alexander, or William Belknap.
Was he from Missouri?
Well, he was born in Wisconsin, close to Chippewa Falls, Wisconsin.
And who was your mother?
Her name was Martha Jane Davis.
And where was she from?
She was born in Virginia. I don't know what town. She came to Missouri before her and my daddy was married. Daddy was in the Civil War.
Which side did he fight on?
Union.
Union? Mm-hmm. Did he ever tell you any stories about the war?
Quite a bit. Mm-hmm. Now, he didn't do no fighting. Most of what he did was to clean up the battlefield. He helped clean up the battlefield at Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. That was one of the last battles of the war.
Yeah. What did he do when he cleaned up the battlefield?
He buried the dead.
Buried the dead?
Mm-hmm.
How long was he in the war?
Oh, sir, I just don't know. He wasn't in too long.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was about over with when he went in. He never did do no fighting. Mm-hmm. And then he explored the nation after the war was over. After the Battle of Gettysburg, which was the last battle of the war. If I am not mistaken. Then he was in the cavalry for some time, I forget how long. Mm-hmm. Depends when he met my mother, was always in the cavalry.
What did he do in the cavalry?
Well, they traveled most of the time. I've forgotten now just where they started from. They come down across Kansas, across Oklahoma out here, west part of Oklahoma, along about where Woodward's at, you know. The Fort Supply, of course, the Fort Supply wasn't there then, but it was organized afterwards. It was built there after he come through.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Nothing in this country but this high grass and buffalo. He went to Texas,
well, how are you today?
Went down through Texas, out of Texas, down through Louisiana, Mississippi, and all that up into the, all back home was discharged. Came to my mother and met, he met her while he was making his rounds, and they got married and they moved back to Wisconsin. Three of us kids who were born in Missouri, the rest of us were born in Wisconsin.
Eight kids.
After the Civil War, what did your father do?
Well,
after the Army.
He went back to Wisconsin. Well, he got married and took his wife back to Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. And they lived back there and they farmed and raised these cranberry marshes. He worked in the timber and saw logs and things like that and took them down the Mississippi River to the sawmill.
What part of Wisconsin did they live in?
They were close to Chippewa Falls, Wisconsin.
When did they move to Missouri?
Well, they must have moved to Missouri. Let's see. The brother on there, he's 4 years older than I am. And our youngest girl. It must have been somewhere in the 80s, somewhere along there.
Yeah.
I don't remember just exact year that they come to Missouri.
Yeah. How big was the town of Conway, Missouri?
How big was it?
Yeah.
Well, sure, they had, when we was there, they had a grocery store, and dry goods all combined. They had a grist mill, and a doctor, two churches, and they had a little brick plant out the side that they made brick, laid them out and dried them. Not like they do out here. They made the brick out of mud. They laid them out on the ground to dry them. And then they could harden and then they could use them. They never did burn them.
Who ran the brick plant?
Huh?
Who ran that brick factory?
Well, sure, I can't remember the man's name.
Mm-hmm.
Now, my brother worked there, but I don't remember his name. See, I was pretty small.
Yeah.
I just don't know.
Do you remember who ran the grist mill?
No, I sure don't.
Was it a water-powered mill?
No, it run by steam.
By steam?
Mm-hmm. Or something, I don't know just what it run by. I knew it didn't run by water, of course. There was no water there. Mm-hmm. Now there was a grist mill at Lebanon, Missouri, that run by water.
Mm-hmm.
But that was the county seat of the county I was born in. We lived, I guess, 15 or 20, maybe 20 miles from there. But I've been to that old grist mill that run by water. Now it's close to... It's a big park now. It was called a... I'll see if I can think of the name of it. Yeah. It was close to Lebanon, Missouri.
Mm-hmm.
Lebanon, Missouri is about, oh, I guess 12, 15 miles from Fort Leonard, Missouri. Of course, Fort Leonard is east, and this big mill was west of Lebanon, Missouri.
Mm-hmm.
And it run by water.
Mm-hmm.
That water would come up out of a big ground hole, big spring hole that I guess is 7 or 8 foot in diameter, and run off, and they built this mill. Well, that water was running out of that spring. It was an artificial well, is what it was. And that mill run by that water that come out of there. And after it left the mill, well, it made a river. They called it the Mogongo River.
Mm-hmm.
And now, since they done away with the mills. Now they made flour, they made cornmeal, they made shorts, bran, everything like that. There, if that water would work for either turn, if the water run through it. But now it's a park.
Is the mill still there?
No. No, the mill is tore down. And we just got a summer resort there. I was there in, in 1945. And the well was there, the artesian well was there just like it was then. And you could throw a big rock in there. The rock would float to the top.
Huh.
That's how strong the water was coming out. Now that was in 45. I was there. 45 was, yeah, I guess it's 45. Because I quit in 46. Yeah, it was 45. They had told that you could throw an anvil in there. And the anvil would come up. Now, I don't know if that's right.
That'd be awful strong water.
Yes, it is. But I know that there was rocks laying around there. No big rock about that big square. The people, if they wanted to, just pick them up, throw them in, and they'd throw it out.
When did you move to Oklahoma?
1901.
How come your folks came to Oklahoma?
Well, the reason they come was from Cowell County, Comanche County, and Caddo County was settled up for settlement. You could file on a claim in any one of those counties, cost you a dollar. And if you was lucky, you got 106 acres of land. If you didn't, well, you lost your dollar.
Did your father get a claim?
No. I'll tell you the reason why he didn't get a claim.
How come?
Well, when we come, Fort Reno used to be a Fort Reno, you know. Of course, it's a penitentiary now. But at that time, there was a bunch of soldiers in there. 1901. And we camped on the creek between Fort Reno and El Reno. The filing was at El Reno. Well, there was 30-some wagons of us. We was camped out there. While we was camped there, well, a bunch of those boys that was in the Fort Reno come by. He stopped and got to talking to us and talking to the rest of them. And they found out, Dad told them that he was a Union soldier, had been in the Civil War. And they said, now, Mr. Belknap says, don't camp down here. He says, drive that wagon and family up there in the fort and stay there. Well, Dad taken them at their word, and we went up. Camped in Fort Reno. While we was there, well, the boys told us that our advice would be to use to not to file here. Says we've been all over that country. Says there's some of it that you can't make a living on. Some of it is mountain. Says some of it is hard pan. Some of it is good land. Says our advice would be to go down there and look at the country. Says there'll be somebody that will want to will file and get a claim. No longer give it up. You can contest him and get his claim. And so Daddy takes him at their word, but it didn't happen that way. No. When they filed on the case, they didn't always stay there. I don't think that, well, we were, my folks rode the country over, and there never was a place that you could live on except those mountains down there. lower part of Powell County. It was a place that was to be leased back to the government or the people follow.
What'd you all do if when you didn't get a claim?
Well, we when we landed in Washoe County, of course he just settled up there. There was about five miles east of where the town of Rocky is now. Now there was no Rocky there at that time. There was just no rock store, just a little post office. But our post office was the name of Euro. Or not Euro, but Rainier. And we was about a mile and a half from that. That's where my brother-in-law lived. Lived in a half dugout. My older sister's man. And of course we came to that place. And then we explored the Powell County after we got there, also over in Caddo, and he just went clear down into Massey County. But we never could find a place. Now there wasn't a house, there wasn't a building of any kind. Except at Hobart, it was a depot, a railroad that ran through there. That's all there was there. We was there the day that the lots were sold. And they built their first house. Well, we went down that morning, stayed all day, and left the next day. And then the next time we went back, about a week, 10 days, what? It was all built up. Houses all over the world. Of course, a lot of people that was coming there to go in business, they brought their equipment with them, had it shipped in there. And the side tracks were full of lumber and furniture and things like that. The first bank they just put in Hobart was put in a tent. He was a carpenter and his daddy was a banker. And the young man used his tool chest for the vault when they opened the bank. Put it in the tent. Now there's, if there's ever Hobart, there's at the southwest corner of the square across the street. Right on the corner.
What was the man's name?
Bullfinger.
Bullfinger?
Bullfinger.
Bullfinger,
yeah.
You got some mail on the table. I'll bring it to you.
Do you remember the trip to Oklahoma?
Pretty well. Remember part of it.
Can you tell me anything that happened on the trip that you remember?
Oh, yeah.
Anything interesting?
I can tell you several things. I know when we started in a wagon by ourselves. Me and my daddy and mother, two sisters and a brother. Well, when we started, it's kind of funny. It's going to be into an old story. It was the 27th day of July, or June, when we got loaded up and ready to start. We had some frying chickens. We'd been eating on them. And so Mother says we'll take about six of these chickens with us. And the first night that we camped, next morning we killed one of them chickens. That left us five. The next day we traveled all day in a wagon. We camped that night. We opened the chicken coop. Them chickens just flew out, you know, raised around. Began to get between sundown dark, they flew back to that chicken coop. We was all feeling pretty tough. As us kids were. And Dad and Mother was too. We never had traveled before in a wagon. Mother says, them chickens might be feeling just as bad as we are. Says, I don't believe I'll kill one of them. So we fried bacon for breakfast. Kept on, and we never did kill them chickens. And there was one rooster in the bunch. And when we got into Oklahoma, come out of Kansas up here close to Coffeyville, I don't know, between Coffeyville and
Caney?
Who?
Caney?
Arkansas City. Okay. Somewhere between there, we crossed the line. After we crossed the Arkansas River, went into Arkansas, Kansas, and we crossed the line and come into Oklahoma. And that rooster crowed that morning. First time he'd ever made any sound at all. And there was about 15 or 20 wagons there were sent. It was all camp. That is kind of a funny deal. Think down with that rooster. Never had crowed or nothing until we got into Oklahoma. And it woke everybody up in the camp. I guess there was 15 or 20, and there was 25 wagons.
Are you all coming to the fire opening?
Yeah, coming to the opening. See, when we started out, we just started out by ourselves. But I think the second or third night, we met up with a couple of young men. They were from Iowa. And they was coming to Oklahoma. Coming to the same place that we was coming to El Reno. They were going to fire one place. But we never did see them after we left and went up in the fort there. We never did see any of them. But the next day after the firing was over, then a bunch of us got together and come on. And we traveled together from El Reno. I guess it was 10 or 12 wagons. Of course, when it was settled up from there to Bridgeport over here. And we crossed the Bridgeport there, across the river to Bridgeport. We forded it. Of course, they had a toll bridge there then. We didn't have enough to pay a dollar to cross that. So we forded the river.
How'd you ford the rivers?
Well, there was a road that come down. Of course, the river wasn't, there wasn't very much water in it. It was a pretty dry summer in 1901. There wasn't much water there. The water was as wide as maybe this room is long. But it was sand, just deep sand.
What about the Arkansas River?
We crossed that on the bridge at Arkansas.
How long did you stay in Bridgeport?
We didn't stop at Bridgeport, only just across the river. After we crossed the river, we hit Caddo County. And then we didn't see any more buildings until we got to Todd Chief. That's in Warstall County. It was the county seat of Warstall County at that time.
What was the name of it?
Todd Chief.
Cloud Chief?
Mm-hmm.
Is it still there?
Yeah. There's not much there, I don't think. I think there's one or two buildings. But at that time, it was a pretty good little town. And was the county seat of Warstall County. But after years, when they built this Santa Fe Road, it stopped down at especially down here. At a roundhouse there. You can come back. They figured it was going on south someday. Now that was in 1901 when we come. Kind of seems over there. So somebody, some of the officials of Warsaw County, they decided they'd move over to Cordell to be there when the railroad came in. So they moved it over there. And they voted to go back to Tauchi, but they never did put it back to Tauchi. The Tauchi was really the county seat of Warsaw.
When did they move to Cordell? What year was that?
That must have been in 1902. And to the best of my recollection, either 1902 or 19 in the fall of 1901, I've forgotten how which.
Now, what did your family do after you didn't get a claim? You said you went to Hobart?
Yeah. But we come back. We didn't move to Hobart. We was living with my brother-in-law on a fellow's place that had a big cotton crop. And my daddy bought some lumber, that is, just footboards. He built up a bowl about 4 foot high, then got a canvas and put some rafters up. Got a canvas for a tent. We lived in that tent that year, the rest of the year. We got here the 27th of July. We lived in that tent and picked cotton around. Then he rented a place about 2 miles east of there. We moved our tent over there, set it up. We lived in that until that fall. Made a crop. And we moved into a big house. We lived in that until we gathered the crop. During that year, my daddy came off up here by our city and filed on a little 8 acres of land that was vacant from the government. Beckham County at that time was, or not Beckham, but Roger Mills County. Roger Mills County at that time.
Did he get the claim?
Yeah, he got 8 acres. We lived on that until I think it was 1909. Moved to Elk City. No, it was not. Yeah, in the fall of 1909. We moved to Elk City.
Do you remember the Depression of 1907 and 1908?
1907, 1908. Yeah.
How bad was that Depression?
1907. Well, it, of course, I don't remember too much about it, but then I remember that people had money in the bank. They couldn't get the money. They couldn't get the money at all.
Mm-hmm. So they closed the banks.
Yeah. And of course then was when it Teddy Roosevelt was our president. And putting all the banks in the United States was going broke. Nobody, if you had $1,000 in there, well, you maybe draw out $5 a day. That's all you could draw out. And that's all you could get. Old Teddy, he says, now that won't do. He says, turn that money loose. Now that was Wall Street that had the money. So Teddy Roosevelt said, I'm just quoting from him. I don't know.
Is that what ended the Depression?
Well, that put a stop to it, yeah. Mm-hmm. It didn't get so bad there. But, of course, wages was always cheap all along through there. But then, and most of the people that had money got all their money back There were some banks that went from under. They lost all their money, but some of them stayed open and got their money back.
Where were you living on statehood day?
When statehood come?
1907.
I was working for my brother-in-law east of Rocky, about 3 miles on the farm.
Were there any celebrations on statehood day?
Oh yeah.
What'd you do with them? What kind of celebrating did you do?
There wasn't too much celebration. They was rejoicing over it. But I know that I had left, my folks lived up at Elk City at that time. I had went to Elk. I was at Elk City when it became statehood. And the liquor went out.
What was Elk City like when liquor went?
Well, when become a statehood and liquor went out, I see there was, I believe, four open saloons there in Elk City. And then south of Elk, about a mile and a half, was a big distill that made liquor. And of course he had a saloon up the town. It wasn't so wild as people would imagine it would be. You've seen a few drunks, but I've seen just as many since Prohibition. I've seen them, I can remember. Of course, I was a pretty good-sized boy then.
So when statehood came and there was no more liquor, Did the town get drunk?
Huh?
Did the town get drunk?
Well, just in a few days, afterwards, you couldn't tell much difference. They didn't have no saloons. Mm-hmm. And I remember real well that they tried to catch all the bootleggers, but they couldn't. I know some of the boys would get on the train and down in Wichita Falls, and they'd buy them a suitcase full of liquor. A lot of them lost it when they crossed the line coming back, and they wouldn't catch the men. They'd have, I know of three that went down there, and he said he'd get his liquor back. So he put it in the suitcase and put it up on the rack, you know. They crossed the line after they left Vernon, Texas, I believe it was. Yeah, Vernon. Before they got to Aldous, a log got on the train and was looking for him. He was sitting well up to the Aldous in front of the train. And it did bother him, but they went back and got his suitcase. Says, here's your suitcase. He was full of liquor and they walked off with it. Now he lost his money and his liquor too.
Were there many people around here making bootleg whiskey?
Well, I don't know about that. Most of the time I was down around Hobart and Elk City at the time. Mm-hmm. But I didn't know if anybody that was actually making it. I've heard of several that didn't make it, but then I didn't know it. Mm-hmm. And I never did mess with it. I've tried to drink some bootleg liquor. I never could drink it. I was afraid of it. Mm-hmm. Some of that stuff would kill you.
What kind of house did your father have on the 80 acres?
Well, when we first went up there, we moved it, taking our little tent outfit. And he dug a half dugout back in the bank and put that tent over the top of it. He lived in that till he could get lumber from Elk City to cover the dugout. And then we dug a dugout, full dugout, above that. And when it was storming, well, we'd go in the dugout.
How big was the dugout?
Oh, it was big enough that there was two beds in it, one on each side, and then a walkway between the beds, and then room back between them. Mm-hmm. It was covered with dirt. Well, it was covered with plank and then dirt on top of it. The ridgepole was a log about that big around. Steps are going down, and the steps come out to the east of the dugout. Mm-hmm.
World War I, 1917. What were you doing?
World War I? I was farming.
Did you go to the war?
No. No, I was married before the war broke out. Had two kids, and I was farming 8 acres of land. Mm-hmm. Just had two horses, two milk cows. No, I had one milk cow at that time. And I was exempt. I was the first to get a registry in Rocky. I was living 1 mile south, 2 miles east of where Rocky's at. Mm-hmm. And I was the first one to register for the war when they actually broke out. I was in 15. And of course, I was exempt then until in 16. I got a notice to be ready at any time to go into the service. And if I left my post office, to leave a forward address wherever I went. Well, I did that. I made one trip out in Texas, stayed out there 3 days. Of course, I had my mail set out there, and I had it to be sent back to Rocky. But I never did get the notice to go. And in October or November 11th, Armistice was signed, as in 1916.
Mm-hmm. What'd you do on Armistice Day?
When it was signed?
Yeah.
Oh my God, that people went wild.
In Rocky?
Yeah. Yeah, there was two gyms there. And they were run by steam. And whistle blowed for about an hour and a half. People were running up and down the street with thin buckets and tubs and everything they could get a hold of. It is quite a rejoicing time.
How big was Rocky?
Oh, there was, at that time, there was, let's see, two grocery stores, a dry goods store, a hardware, or hotel, lumber yards, two elevators. Post office.
Who was the postmaster?
Yeah, let me think now. I believe his name was Tom Cannon.
Who was the banker?
Walter B. Stevens. They had two banks there. Bank was a man with my name Bowen from the other bank. And this First National Bank was one of them. That was the Walter B. Stevens Bank. He's still there.
Where was your 80 acres?
Those 3 acres. From the west side of Elk City, that is section line, it comes down to Elk City. It's on Washington and Washington Street. Of course, it's all over there now, but west of there, there wasn't much of Elk City. But south of there, or east of there, was the town. We was 8 miles south and a mile west of there, on the farm.
How far is that from Rocky?
That is from Elk City.
Oh, okay. What was your wife's name?
Her name was Bertie. Alexander.
When did you get married?
We got married the 22nd day of December, 1912.
How many kids do you have?
I had 9 born to me. One passed away when she was 2 years old. The rest of them lived to be grown. I lost a daughter. Let's see. I forget how much years it was because it must have been 89 or 74, I believe, when my oldest daughter passed away.
How long do you stay on the farm?
31.
What'd you do in 31?
We broke.
The Depression?
Yeah.
What'd you do?
I moved down and leased to Derry.
To Elk City?
No, at Hobart.
Hobart. Mm-hmm. You leased a dairy?
Yeah, I leased a dairy.
Before you lost your farm, was this the same 80 acres?
Oh, no. Mm. No, this is 220 acres. That I was renting, I was just renting that. That was 5 miles north and a mile west of Hobart. And I'd been on the place for 11 years. And in 30, I got 20 $0.75 a bushel for wheat. And I had a bunch of cows. I guess I had cows and calves. I think it was about 20 head. Had a good big pasture. And then in 31, I didn't make no crop. That is, made a crop, but couldn't get nothing for it. And the landlord wanted to, me to sell my horses. I was a farmer, two horses. I had 6 head of horses, 2 row tools, and these cattle, and I was making a living with these cows, you see. I was selling milk and hold for the quart. But that wasn't making my landlord anything. So he decided in 31 for me to trade these cows and horses, get a tractor and plow up the pastures. I couldn't see it. So I let him rent the place to somebody that did have a tractor. And then I couldn't find a place to put my cattle. So I kept them, rented the pasture for them, drawn the horses out. People had wanted them, I couldn't sell them, couldn't get nothing for my cows. In fact, I couldn't sell them. Cattlemen wouldn't buy them. They wouldn't pay the freight. Oklahoma City. Well, I kept them until in 32. And then when they began to plow up the cotton, plow up the feed, or the wheat, and kill the cattle off. That person didn't have no place to put them. Well, I got $16 a head from the cattle and seen them killed out in the pasture. We put up enough beef to last us for 2 or 3 years. Mm-hmm. Then I went broke in this dairy, milked that down to 3 or 4 cents a quart. And I couldn't pay the rent on that. Since then, it's just been these hands. I've never made nothing, amount to anything.
Mm-hmm. After you didn't keep the dairy, what'd you do?
I went to work for the gin and oil mill there in Orbit.
What'd you do in the gin?
Well, and again, I off-bagged cotton, hauled it to the compress. I would put in 12, 14, 16 hours a day, 10 cents an hour. And I went to work to oil mill.
What's an oil mill?
That's where they grind these cottonseed like this big mill down here. Of course, it's a small mill. Hobart is a farmer's owned oil mill. And I went to work there, and I'd work there in the wintertime, fall and winter. In the summertime, I'd do anything that I could get to do. And there wasn't much to do until the WTA started. After he started, well, I done pretty good.
What'd you do for WPA?
I built these bridges, rock bridges, on the county roads.
What salary were you making?
In Cowell County. Mm-hmm.
How much money were you making?
I was making, I believe I was getting 40 cents an hour. For, I think, 15 days. And then I was off 15 days. Just worked 15 days is all I could work on WPA. And I was off 15 days. But when I'd get off, I was building a road from Frederick, 183 Highway. I got in with the contractor. I'd go down there and work till my time come to go back on WPA, and I'd work my time out on WPA, and then I'd go back to him as long as he was working on it. And after they got their contract filled, or they moved out, and I'd work at the oil mill then, and he'd start up in the fall. Otherwise, it was just whatever I could get to do.
What were the dust bowls like during that period? A dust storm? What was the dust storm like?
It was bad. Now, it was so bad sometimes that you couldn't hardly see to drive for hours at a time. There was no form of it. Most of the dust come from the west part of the state out here in the Panhandle.
Had to keep you out of your house?
Well, we just had to keep the door shut. Of course, now that wouldn't last too long here. The wind would blow pretty hard here, but the dust was settling here. But the dirt was getting up out there. I know one time, got in with an old boy that had a truck. We come to Elk City one day from Hobart, load up a load of cotton, bales of cotton to take to Dallas to the compress down there. Well, that day that we loaded it up, it was so dusty and dirty you couldn't hardly see, maybe a quarter of a mile. Here, the wind was blowing hard, but there was no dirt getting up here to mount anything at all. The dirt was coming in from the Panhandle. And the next morning we got up, as we got back to Hobart that night, and the wind quit blowing that night. We got up the next morning about 7 o'clock and started to Dallas. And we got down this side of Decatur, Texas. We run into that dust of falling, you know what I mean? Now he down went by us and fell on our truck as we were going down. It just began to settle down, you know what I mean? Just this side of Decatur, Texas.
Have you heard of the Black Duster?
Black Duster. No, I don't know.
That was the big dust storm in 35 or 36. It may have been farther north, though. I think it was up around Woodward and Gage up in that area.
Oh, yeah.
They may not have gotten this far south.
Well, it was the same time that this was going. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't. And most of our dust come from the Panhandle of Oklahoma, out there in Beaver and Ellis County. It would settle here. You can see it on the houses and on the ground. You can see the dust, a different dust to what we have here. Now, here to get back, you couldn't see the sun at all. A lot of days here, and there wouldn't be a cloud in the skies. But that dust would just hide the sun.
How'd you breathe?
Well, you just breathe, that's all. That's it. Breathe the best you could.
What were you doing when the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor?
Where was I at? I was working for the state. And I believe I was up here by a little town by the name of Strong City, putting in some jetties on the Oyster River. And they bombed Pearl Harbor.
What was your first thought when you heard the news?
Well, I didn't know. We come in, work was boarding with a fellow by the name of Baggett. And when we come in from work that night, he told us that he'd hit over the radio that the Japs had bombed Pearl Harbor. We didn't know how bad or anything until the next day when we got out that it was worse than they thought it was. So it was a pretty bad deal. And so I've been told.
What did you do during World War II?
World War II?
Yeah.
I was working here for the city. I was first working for the county, for the state, when World War II started out. And I worked for the state a couple of years, and when they built this Navy base out here, opened that up and put the Navy out there. Well, I went to work out there on civil service.
What'd you do out there?
Well, my first job was setting out grass. And then they put me down to working at the incinerator, burning up the waste, papers and clothing, such as the Navy boys would throw away, you know. Had a big incinerator down there, we just threw it in there, burn it up. Well, while I was working there, the captain came down one day. I had a couple little boys gathering up paper. The government had asked for the Boy Scouts to gather up all the paper that they could get and ship it to the government for use again, that the government needed it. The paper was running short. So that captain, he come down there one day. I was burning up a lot of paper and waste. I told him, I said, it's a darn strange thing to me why that the government will have little boy scouts out of giving that paper to bail and to ship to the government, and you out here are burning it up. I said, we burnt more paper out here than all the scouts in Clinton could gather up in a month. We burn it up in a day, 2 days' time. He says, Belknap, he says, you've got something there. He says, this hadn't ought to be done. Well, he went off, he come back the next day, asked me, he says, would you be interested in bailing that paper and taking care of it? If I will furnish you a building and a bailer. He says, I said, yeah, I would. And so he did. He put me up into a building by myself, and all the waste paper, I baled it, the clothing, I kept it, and the shoes I kept, all the waste that come from that Navy boys would come down there to me, and I'd take care of it, and I'd ship it out. Even shipped out carloads of stuff, carloads of paper. We just absolutely throw it away. It's better being closed up. But after we started the bailing, after we started saving the waste from the airplanes, you see they had quite an airplane deal out there at that time in the Navy airplane. I put up three or four airplanes absolute airplanes were ones that had been over in the service and had been brought back to salvage. Mm-hmm. I got a cutting torch and cut them up, put them in a boxcar. And a lot of things that was iron and things like that, and tin and metal of all kinds. I shipped out, I don't know how many carloads of stuff that I shipped out of there. And it was all useful stuff. It'd be used again. Mm-hmm. And I shipped a lot of shoes to different places, destitute places where people need them. Good shoes now, and boys, if you have ever in the Army or in the Navy, you know about what they do. If the man that cleaned up the barracks, if you left everything on the floor, boy, he threw that out. If you left a brand new shoe sitting there, well, he threw that out. I've got brand new shoes that wasn't hardly worn at all down there. They'd leave one shoe sitting on the floor somewhere. The man had cleaned up while he'd put it out in the waste paper basket. And sheets, pillow slips, everything like that. And all kind of clothing. Well, I'd taken care of all that. We'd ship it out to different places. Of course, I didn't do the shipping now, but Navy done the shipping part of it, but I loaded it up and got it ready to ship. But they done the shipping themselves. Now where it went, I don't know.
What'd you do on VE and VJ Day?
On what?
VE Day and VJ Day when the Germans and the Japanese surrendered. You know, when World War II ended.
I was here in town. I was working out at the Navy base at that time. Navy base was still running. They had quite a time.
Was it a big celebration like Armistice Day?
Yeah. Wasn't, I don't believe it was as big as was Armistice Day.
I'd like to regress for a minute. Whenever your parents first told you that you were moving to Oklahoma from Missouri, what was your first thought?
I don't know. Didn't think very much about it until we got started. I heard them talking about it, but then I really didn't understand what it was all about. Although I knew I had a sister, my older sister lived out here. And her kids were just about my age. Her oldest girl was just about a year and a half, 2 years younger than I was. No, about 3 years younger than I was. Well, I thought lots of them. My thoughts was to see them again. More than anything else. I didn't think anything about how long it'd take us or anything, how long we'd be on the road, anything like that.
Did you go to school in Conway?
No. I went to school at a schoolhouse by the name of Twilight. Out in the country.
Is that in Missouri?
Yeah.
You say you live 3 miles from the school?
Mm-hmm.
And you had to walk?
Yeah.
What was your teacher's name?
That's it. Her name was Miss Russell.
What was your favorite subject in school?
My favorite subject was, I guess, a song about the first reader. I passed out of the first reader into the second. Mm-hmm. And that's my school. I take the second reader.
How far did you go in school?
How far in school? I just passed from the second to the third. Never did take the third grade.
Didn't?
Mm-hmm. Second grade is all right. I take the second grade. Mm-hmm. Of course, at that time, there wasn't counted grades as readers. Mm-hmm. The first reader. I went to the ABCs, and then the first reader. And then into the second reader. But I never did go to the third at all. Yeah. When we come here to Oklahoma, I never went to school in Oklahoma.
You didn't? Mm-mm. How come?
Well, we was in hard shape, and I had to help make a living what I could.
Mm-hmm. There was a General Belknap in Indian Territory for a while. Are you related to him?
Sir, I don't know.
He was commander of Fort Washita for a while.
Yeah.
And in fact, I think he's buried down there.
Yeah. Down here.
Fort Sill?
No. The fort ain't there anymore. The older fort is in the state of Oklahoma. Down here close to Hugo, not too far from Hugo, Oklahoma. I got the name of that town. I've got a piece in the paper.
Fort Washita's on over east around Medill, in that area.
I think so.
Yeah.
But this was in Oklahoma.
Yeah.
And he was a general of this fort down here in eastern Oklahoma.
General Belknap?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But now, whether he was any relation to me or not, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I never did see any of my daddy's folks to know. Now, they were all in Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. And as far as I know, his brothers and his sisters all died in Wisconsin. Yeah. He was the only one that I know of that ever left Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. Now, he had four brothers. Let's see. Yeah. And three brothers. Well, there's four brothers. And I believe either four or five sisters, and I forget now which. We corresponded with his brothers and sisters up until his last sister passed away.
They all live in Wisconsin?
They lived in Wisconsin.
Mm-hmm.
And her niece, my aunt's niece, wrote my wife a letter and told her that her aunt had passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the last of the Belknap family. And my wife answered the letter, but we never did hear from her anymore at all. So I don't know.
Yeah. When did you see your first Indians in Oklahoma?
Oh, we were at Bridgeport.
What'd they look like?
They looked funny.
What do you remember about them?
Well, when we got there to Bridgeport, there was a bunch of little boys and I guess some girls, I don't know. They all looked like girls. And they wanted to chew tobacco. My brother had a plug of tobacco. You know, every one of them little dickens was taking the chew off in that plug and got back, there wasn't very much left of it. Them little devils were just little bitty ones, looked like about 4 or 5 years old. They taken a big chew, but just as soon as they got away from us, they taken it out of their mouth and gave it to the big boy. That's what I Remember about my first Indians that I seen.
What kind of Indians were they?
I don't know. Mm-hmm. They were just Indians.
What about around here? Around Rocky in this area?
Well, these Indians here now. There's two tribes of them. Mm-hmm. There's a Cheyenne Indian and then the Arapaho Indian. The Arapaho and the Cheyenne, they're two different tribes. Then they've got another tribe in Cowell County, different tribe to what these are up here. And then down in eastern Oklahoma, they've got another tribe. It's called the Cherokee. Well, you can't hardly tell them from white people. That is in their way of conducting themselves. But now you can tell the difference in the, a lot of them here, the Arapahoes and the Cheyenne. Mm-hmm. One of them is a little lower down, seems like they get a pretty good education and they're pretty nice until they get older, then they just drop back down to what they were to start eating. I've known that to be done in several different cases. Worked with an old boy out here at the Navy base. He was Indian. He had a good education. And he worked for the captain. Right up in the captain's office. Fine man. His name was Goose. Well, after the war was over, 2 years after, met him one day and didn't know him. He just dropped back down, just with the old rabbit hole we did. We got everything, I guess. Just didn't care, you see. But while he was working out there, he dressed good and looked good, and was smart. Well, he was still smart after he threw himself away. I don't know what makes him do it, but then he did. After we left Bridgeport, there was about five wagons, I guess, after we left there and was coming west. And we crossed the river at Bridgeport and hit Caddo County. We didn't see any more houses. Well, of course, we stopped for, I believe, for dinner one day. Me and my older sister, after we'd eat dinner, we just walked on down a little old trail. There was no roads, just trails. This cow pass, you might say. So there's a little creek down, about a quarter of a mile from where we camped. We went down there, and after we did our dinners, while we was down there, well, we seen a bunch of Indians coming from somewhere. I don't know where they was coming from, but they was going to El Reno. There was about five or six wagons, three or four horses leading and riding, and a dozen or two dogs. Oh, I don't know what all. But we seen them and we was afraid they were going to come down by where we was at, so we hid in some bushes down in that creek. Wasn't much of a creek, just a little branch. Well, the folks there was about a quarter of a mile from us. They seen them Indians go by. They was going down a different trail. And they missed us. They wondered where we'd get to. Some of them said if we walked off down towards the creek, some of them said them Indians might have picked us up. A lot of theirs are all hunting around over that prairie first, you know. We're just about ready to take after that Indian trail, you know. There was 4 or 5 wagons of them. They thought they sure that they had got us. My brother come riding down a horseback and crossed pretty close to where we was at. We could hear them hollering, but we didn't know whether it was them or whether it was them Indians hollering. We'd seen them. So we, after we recognized my brother's voice, or we got out and hollered at him. And then he rode back up and told him that he was down there ahead. But they was just ready to, the man was, to get on the horses and go after that Indian bunch. Mm-hmm. Of course, they just knowed sure that they'd picked us up. Mm-hmm. But they hadn't come very close. They'd come close enough that we seen them, but we was hid in those bushes where they didn't see us. Mm-hmm. Mm. Now, we didn't have any more trouble then after that. We got into Tau Chief on a big ring. We camped out a little bit northeast of Tau Chief, I think. Come rain. We drove up into Tau Chief the next day, and the men was out there throwing mud balls at one another. Now, they were just as happy as they could be. First rain they'd had for months or two. Mm-hmm. And it was dry. But they were so happy over the rain that they just out there throwing mud at one another. Now men, grown men, right out in the streets. Now that was quite a sight to see.
Yeah. Well, do you have any other comments or stories about your childhood or coming to Oklahoma? Or...
Well, when we camped there on the Arkansas River, we stayed there a couple of days. Of course, I'd thinking about cowboys all the time when we get to Oklahoma, and I'd got a hold of me a cotton rope. Oh, it was, I guess, maybe 8-10 foot long. And I'd made me a lariat rope out of it. Well, that morning when we got up, that morning, second night after we camped there the night before and got up, it was right on the bank of that river, the cabin place. They was, oh, I don't know how many wagons there was. Anyhow, we was out there on the river bank, seen a big school of fish. Looked like they was big as a man, just sticking their heads up out of the water, you know. Daddy went back to the wagon and got an old rifle, cap and ball rifle. He shot into them. Well, when he shot into them, one flopped up. Oh, it looked like it was about that long. My brother jumped in the river and caught it. Well, of course, when he caught it, well, the fish went down. Got so deep, my brother had to turn it loose and come up. Well, that evening, about 4 o'clock in the evening, me and my sister was younger sister was playing down on the river bank, you know, just walking along. I hadn't looked down and seen a fish floating like that. Barely was moving. Well, I taken that rope that I had and tied it to a little sapling on the end of it. I held that down in front of that fish. He stuck his head in the loop. I drawed it up. And of course, he went to the water again, shook that bush. We tried to pull him out, me and my sister couldn't. So we went, sister run back up to the camp. Daddy and another man come down and pulled it out, and his It was about that long. Had scales on it as big as half a dollar. We had fish to eat for breakfast the next morning. For dinner and supper the next morning.
3 or 4 feet long?
Yeah. Oh, it is a big.
What kind of fish was it?
Well, I believe they called it a buffalo. I ain't sure. But I know it was a big one and had the scales on it for as big as a half a dollar.
Mm-hmm.
I know we go fish for dinner that day, but for supper that night it was. Breakfast the next day. And we gave our neighbors a lot of fish.
Mm-hmm. How many grandkids do you have?
How many grandkids? I believe I've got 20. No, 19 grandkids.
I mean great-grandkids.
Great-grand? I think it's about 24 or 5 now.
Have any great-great-grandkids?
4. Great-great.
It's a pretty good legacy.
Pretty good little bunch.
Mm-hmm. They all live around here?
No. Some of them's in Oregon, some of them's in Chicago, some in Texas, and some in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm. Well, Mr. Belknap, I think we have a good interview.
Huh?
I think we have a pretty good interview.
I don't know if anything else that I can tell you, only I know it. I've had a devil of a hard time. And a good time, too. I was, me and my wife lived together 54 years and 6 months. Mm-hmm. And of course, it wasn't all on a bed of roses.
Mm-hmm.
We had hard times and good times. We had it up and down. We never did have no fight. We disagreed a lot of times. But our disagreement would come out. And it all would be to it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.